report for today, 2019, 18th of the 9th, the week before the midterm. So actually we covered this part last time a little bit very quickly, but let's take a look at this. So I used to mention before that the measurement by the strain gauge is possible by three major let's call it completion, the bridge completion. So that includes the first, which is a quarter bridge, second is the half bridge, and the third one is a full bridge. The quarter bridge, actually you need just one strain gauge to pick up the strain from your substrate. Half bridge, you'll be able to get more sensitivity in some case. I'm not saying that you will get more sensitivity than quarter bridge, because if you just use it for the measurement of tensile strain, just axial strain, the sensitivity will be the same as the quarter bridge. Okay, and then we come to the full bridge. Of course the full bridge give us the more sensitivity, so practically at least double the sensitivity of the quarter bridge measurement. So in some cases that you need higher sensitivity, you can opt for the full bridge measurement. But anyway, right, we look at this one by one in more detail than last time. So the quarter bridge measurement, one strain gauge. Okay, when you go for the quarter bridge mode, it is the mode in the data acquisition program. So you need one strain gauge, and the completion and the hookup of this strain gauge, there are two possibilities. But basically well, we look at this picture a little bit, that the first one, this is the material, this is the support. So this piece of structure is subjected to the tension. Okay, so you have tensile strain. When you have tension, and when you make the measurements, the resistance that you have come from first the original R from your strain gauge from the factory, right? The second is the delta R1, which is the contribution from the real strain, real mechanical strain in your member, right? The third one, the delta RM, this thing I generally include, this includes R for the lead Y that may not change during the measurement, but you also have the delta R of lead Y, because the lead Y will be subjected to the temperature change. The lead Y could be subjected to some sort of stretching a little bit. It could be. We try not to touch the lead Y, but sometimes it happens. And this includes also the temperature strain, so the epsilon T, which is not the mechanical strain, is also included. So I put this delta RM, and I use this thing to represent something that is undesirable in our measurement. Because we place the strain gauge, generally we want to know the mechanical strain. Sometimes we want to know temperature strain, but for here I group all of those undesired resistance into the delta RM. All right. Well, if you want to measure the strain, which is the result from the bending in the beam, okay, and if you use the quarter bridge completion, you are going to put the strain gauge either top or bottom. That will send you the tensile or compressive strain as well. And then it will be identical to the case we talk about, which we're going to have the strain, which is mechanical, and then add up with the lead-wire resistance change, and also the temperature strain. So I show you this, all right? But the two measures set up in the data acquisition module, the control in the program. So you will check, you will select the measurement type, and the measurement type for quarter bridge, we have two options. The first is two wires, and the second is the three wires measurements. I mentioned before that the two wires measurements is possible for the short wire, all right? Short wire. Or if the strain gauge is compensated from the factory, so the resistance of the lead wire, sometimes it is significant, sometimes it is not that small, but from the factory, the compensation was carried out. So if you need 120 ohm, and the lead wire makes you 3 ohm, so the factory will reduce the resistance of the strain gauge from 120 down to 117, and then adds up with 3, then you get a perfect 120. So the perfect 120 will be close to the 120 ohm of the dummy resistance, the resistors that you use to complete the circuits, like this. These are the resistors, okay, and this is just one strain gauge in the circuit, okay. So you have this quarter bridge that is 2-wire system. So if you use quarter bridge 2-wire system, you can come to this diagram in the manual of the data logger. It's gonna show the wiring diagram. Basically, this diagram will be applicable to all Japanese data acquisition system. In the US system, then you look at the diagram for each machine. Anyhow, so this locker, you will have three terminals that you need to deal with, A, B, C. In the terminal, you have A, B, C, D, E, all right? But just quarter bridge completion, you have just A, B, C. So if you have just two wires, I talk a little bit already. So this A is actually hooked up at this point, okay, in the bridge circuit. So I think it is better to know that when you plug something to A, what is that A? So A is the excitation voltage, B is the signal minus, okay, it is this node. And the C is actually this point here. It is different. The wiring diagram in the quarter bridge, A, B, and C, the C in quarter bridge could be different from the C in the full bridge. All right? It could be different. So over here, you can see A, B, C like this. That means between B and C, you will need the wires to connect. And if you have just two wire system, you need to do this point here between B and C. Between B and C, so you know, you will do the short circuiting, right? So show you that last time. Okay, the Y comes into A, but the Y that comes to B, and we do something like this. So at the terminal, you lock it with the screw and lock it with this screw. So this thing is a short circuit that makes the B and C connected. Okay, this is how. So talk about this already, but yeah, I add something in here. So if we look into the equations that tells you the relationship between the output voltage and the input voltage as the resistance is changing. So you have R1, okay, come back here. This is R1, this is R2, this is 3, and this is 4, okay? So R1 over R2, that's on the left leg. R4 over R3 plus R4, that's on the right leg. Okay, is there. The active gauge is R1 only. R2, 3, 4 are the constant resistance. So the resistance will not change in the resistor. Sorry, the resistor will not change. Okay, will not produce any change. So you can plug in the value R2 being R, R4 being R, R and R. Right. So there is only just R1. R1 that you have. This is the original resistance. The 2RL. RL is a lead wire resistance. Okay, lead wire resistance. Delta R is a part that is strain. Actually, delta R right now might also pick up the other kind of strain as well. Yeah. Okay, so, and then we plug in R1 down here as well, plus R. Okay, so over here on this side, you get a half. Over here on the left fraction, you get this. And you try to work on this mathematics. So take this to that side, take 2, multiply by that side, you get all of this. 2R cancel out. You have 2 delta R minus delta R. You get just 1 delta R here. 4RL and 2RL minus, you get 2RL. Alright. The denominator is just 4R, 4RL, 2 delta R. Okay. You come to this last expression here. You end up with this. Well, the delta R over R, this is a small number strain, right? The delta R, the change is insignificant. It is 1 in 1,000 when the strain is large. It is 1 in 1,000,000 when the strain is small. So this is insignificant. We just don't count this one. The RL over R, we should keep it there. Right, because the RL could be like 3 ohm, it could be like that. Sometimes it could go up to 10 ohm when the wire is like about 30 meters or 40 meters long. It could be about 10 ohm. So we keep it. Okay, it is significant. So 10 out of 120, that makes you about 10%, right, for this magnitude. In order to reduce the effect from the cable length, you can, one approach, you can use the high resistance strain gauge. So if you use that it is available but not generally used. But if you use 1,000 ohm strain gauge, 1,000 ohm strain gauge, the ratio RL doesn't change, right? Lead wire is just fixed number. So it is 10 still, but if the R is 1,000, you have 1 in 100 ratio. So it doesn't really bother. But anyway, this is going to be kept in your equations, in your expression there. The point that the issue is that everything is just okay. only just this part here. This part here in red, the RL over delta, the RL over R, actually, sorry, it's the RL over R, because, okay, delta R, yeah, that's right. We pull out the delta R, and we pull out the R at the denominator, okay. So RL over delta R, the RL, what is that? 2, 3, 4 ohms. Delta R, it is small, right? So RL over delta R will turn out to be a large number. If the lead wire is longer and longer, and if there is no compensation made from the factory, then this magnitude in red will be significant. And when it is significant, then the range of the measurements, you'll be getting some problem in there. Because the V output over V excitation will be large. This number will be large. Well, if you rewrite this equation above in this term, you will just replace this term. The delta R by R is actually the gauge factor multiplied by strain. Change of resistance is equal to gauge factor multiplied by strain. So I want to set up some coefficient. So if I put this, I move things around to the other side, then you get this. This is coming out from your data acquisition system. It gives you volt per volt output. Okay. The reading that you get from the CSV file, or the data file. CSV file is Excel compatible, so you can just open in Excel. It doesn't have the extension .exel, but this is like .csv, but you double click, it opens in Excel, and you can read the data in CSV file. So what you receive in CSV file, in general data logger, you get the volt per volt unit. Okay, if you use Japanese, it will give you the micro strain, but that means it has been, something has been processed. So it picks up, it reads out the volt per volt first, and then it multiplies by some coefficient, which for me, my preference, I prefer the volt per volt, and then I can just take care of this coefficient outside. But if you take care, if you input the coefficient into the data acquisition program for Japanese data logger, well, you will get the microstrain unit outside. But sometimes, if you put that coefficient incorrectly in the program, that you will have no clue, you will have no trace to check if something goes wrong. The strain reading is equal to the volt per volt multiplied by this coefficient. Okay, so the gauge factor for metal foil gauge is equal to 2. Okay, metal foil gauge, normal constant metal foil gauge, 2. So your strain is equal to 4 divided by 2. Turns out to be 2. Okay, 4 divided by 2 turns out to be 2. So you put this coefficient, approximately 2, into your data acquisition program. But it doesn't mean that you just put the gauge factor in there. Alright? It is just by accident that we have the 4 divided by gauge factor, which is pretty much like 2. So you have the 2 as the coefficient in the program. But it doesn't like you put 2 in that coefficient because it is the gauge factor. You put 2 in there because it is the 4 divided by 2. So in the case that you have the gauge factor which is not 2, like 60, so what do you put in there? You put the 4 divided by 60. You don't put 60, semiconductor 120. So you put 4 divided by 120, right? You are not putting 120 in there, okay? Because many times I think people get confused. People read, oh, the gauge factor is 2. So I use this number 2, and I put this number 2 into the setup of the data acquisition system, which is, many times a fluke, because it is accidentally equal. But all right, we come to this detail, so hopefully you get things done right. The point is that these two we talk about, sometime if you want to correct your lead Y effect, you have this. You have this. So generally, for general case that the lead Y is not high, resistance is not high, then you use 4 over GF. But sometimes if you want to include the lead Y, it has to be there. So you will have 4 plus probably 4 and then 3 out of 120, 3 ohm out of 120 ohm, 12 cancel with 12, you get 110, so you get 4.1 divided by the gauge factor. If the gauge factor on the side of the package is like 2.01, then you put the precise value in there, and then you will get some number which is not 2. Well, that depends. If you want to be easy, you put 2. But if you feel like if this is calculated properly, then you get 2.05. So this is about 2.5%. 2.5% off. Up to you, right? You are running the experiment. If you get this 2-3% accuracy, which is better, why don't? But if you just decide to be sloppy, okay, fine. Or you can first just get the volt per volt, and then you can come back and do this cleaning up adjustment. Later you'll be getting better number. All right, so understand how to this detail just enable you to do the precise interpretation and measurement. Now it is just up to you what if you want to do it or not. But we just emphasize at this point where we going to have a large drift from the effects from the 2Y completion. 2Y quarter bridge completion. Now, 3Y system. I checked with the document from the different supplier, and then it looks just like this. So I think it makes more sense. The last time I showed you, I request verbally, I asked verbally, and I got the response, and then I follow that response, and I don't think that it is quite correct for that completion the way the system was wired last time. So I make some adjustment, so this is updated. Okay, so 3Y system, okay, what we have. So 3Y, you know 1Y is going to be here and jump to terminal A, another Y jump to terminal B, another Y jump to terminal C. So previously we had the short circuit going on here for the quarter bridge 2Y system. Now 3Y system, we don't need this short circuit. And then this node here, okay, this point here will be equivalent to this point here on the circuit. We just move it up, and then we push the so this is one system, this is your R2. Okay? Your R2 now has the R plus the lead Y resistance. Your R1 has the R1 plus drain plus the lead Y resistance. So you have R1 with the lead Y and R2, you include the lead Y as well. Alright? You increase both. It means you now incorporate the effects from the lead Y and the correction will be possible. Over here, this lead Y, it doesn't do anything because the lead Y resistance out from this point here to here, it doesn't alter any current flow in the Wheatstone bridge circuit because this resistance add up with the galvanometer resistance, which is very high. I told you last time that galvanometer, the flow of the current will be very small, right? The resistance is huge. So infinity plus this one, it doesn't change anything. Okay. All right. So we come to the equation for the bridge. So now you know R1 is including the lead Y, and R2 is also including the lead Y. R3 and R4, they are left untouched, they are not changed. So we will do something with just these three fellows. Well, this part here turns out to be a half, there's no change. R divided by 2R. R1, you have the original resistance. You have the lead Y resistance. This could include the delta RL as well. Okay, just we just put them into this term, lead Y resistance, and delta R here. Still, this delta R could include the temperature strain. All right. Down here you have R for the number one lead Y and delta R for resistance number two. You have the R add up with the lead Y. You add everything up, you get this, and then you multiply, you get this, 2R cancel out, lead Y cancel out, you have only a term of delta R, okay, and then this denominator is still there. When we came into this room, I thought that it will be quiet today because no activity is going on now. It is completely noisy. And then we pull out the delta R over R. So top here, numerator you get one, denominator you get this. This is insignificant. We cue it out. If you want to keep nonlinear equation, that's up to you, but this is really insignificant, so we cue it out. L over R, now we keep it just in case if you want to do this correction. If it is insignificant, then you don't include it. Okay, we come down to this equation here, we reduce that one off, and then we just switch things around, and then the R over delta R turns out to be that the gauge factor times strain. Right, so you have this as a coefficient. Again, this coefficient, if your gauge factor is 2, then the whole thing turns out to be 2. Coefficient multiplied by vol per vol, you get strain. Now, let's see. I think you need to get some sense of how this coefficient is going to affect your measurement. The limitation is at this vol per vol measurement, right? The resolution of your reading. For example, the vol per vol, if your galvanometer, your A2D, can make a resolution of 1 microvolt reading. 1 microvolt reading excitation could be 2 volt. That makes 0.5 microvolt per volt. So that's the base resolution of your hardware. And that 0.5, which is fixed. So if you want to use this A2D for quarter bridge, 0.5 microvolt per volt, full bridge, 0.5 microvolt per volt, it doesn't change. Okay, the only thing that changes is the coefficient here. So the bigger the coefficient is, the worse, right? Because you have the fixed resolution from the voltage reading. So the coefficient that multiply to the voltage reading is going to determine how big is your one step reading. So 0.5, and then if you meet up with 2, you end up with 1 microstrain reading. If this number is smaller than 2, you have smaller microstrain. Okay, so for the full bridge, you end up with you can end up all the way to, like, it's not 2, it could be all the way up to 0.5 for this coefficient. So that's gonna make this resolution better. So I just want you to get the sense of how this thing affects the quality of your measurement. And this coefficient for quarter bridge is the biggest one. Quarter bridge gives you the worst resolution. Okay. So if you connect by 3 different approaches, 3 different type, you get different resolution of your strain. Alright. The beauty of this quarter bridge is that you don't have the part over here like quarter bridge 2 wise. We are doing quarter bridge 3 wise, right? So quarter bridge 2 wise, you have something big over here, but 3 wise, that big thing has gone. So it is possible to hook it into your data acquisition system and it still remain in the readable range. Because if you have a large drift, initial drift out from 0, then you will be out of range very easily, and then your test has to, well, the reading will stop somewhere before you finish the test. I mentioned, like, if the range of the reading covers up to 20,000 microstrain, but you start with the 15,000 microstrain, then you test for just a while, and then you have 5,000 adds up with the existing 15,000, then it is out of the measurement range, and you don't get any value out from that point on. So maybe it is just a quarter way of your test, and everything and some strain gauge is out of range. Okay, so that is undesirable situation. Okay, all right. But anyway, this part here, so no matter how long the cable is, you can adjust it in this coefficient. Okay, so it doesn't mean that we have 3-wire system and you don't care about the lead wire. Okay, 3-wire system improve the condition of the initial reading. You don't get terrible initial reading, which will lead you to out of range situation easily. But still, you shouldn't just take the coefficient being just 2.0 because right now it is going to be significant. Okay, so include this, all right, 3%, 5% sometimes. I used in some project, we have like the big specimens, and the lead wire is about 12 or 10. Ah, let's make it 10 ohm. 10 ohm, so you multiply by 4, you get 40 ohm. Divide by 120, it is 1/3. 1/3 is 33%, right? Which is 0.33. So you have 4 plus 0.33. This is 4.33. Or sometimes even 4.4. 4.4 divided by 2, you get 2.2. So that makes you 20%. Okay. 20% is significant. So do correct it. Okay. Well, you're going to have much better feeling when you hook up the strain gauge to a data locker and do the pre-setting, and when you drop in the coefficient, you feel better. But if you want to do it after math, actually the data locker from Japan, it is possible to put 2 as a default, but you can put 1 also. As far as I remember, you can put the pre-configure number, you can put 1. If you put 1, then you get the volt per volt. Okay. And you get volt per volt, you come back and you check gauge by gauge, because at the job site, some wire is 30 meters, some wire is 50 meters, some wire is 60 meters. So the RL is different. And then it is very slow to just key in the value one by one for each of them. So maybe easier to just put 1 throughout, but you know that this gauge is this long. So you use all this RL correction after math, after the test. If you want to get some rule of thumb number, then you just get the number multiplied by 2. During the load, during the testing, you might want to know, for now, is this still yielding? You just look at this volt per volt multiplied by 2. If it is quarter bridge, then you know that, it is about to yield. But it is just the decision making number during the test. You want to see if something goes wrong. It cracks a lot already. Why isn't it yield? You can come check the number, or you can come check if there is anything wrong. At that moment, you don't need to be like getting the 5%, 3% precision. 1,400 microstrain will probably it yields. It is about this number, so it could be used for managerial decision making. Okay, multiply by 2, but or you multiply by 2 throughout, that is also possible. So the number that shows up at the screen is the approximate strain value. But you come back, you clean the data out, dividing them out by 2, you come back with the volt per volt, and then you just remultiply by the precise coefficient. That is another technique to do. Okay. Believe me, I think most of the people, when they conduct the measurement, they don't have any idea about how this thing really works. So we done with quarter bridge. We talk about the different system of measurement. It will be the half bridge. But half bridge, okay, sometimes you get the equivalent effect to the quarter bridge, but that equivalent effect, you have some part of the temperature strain cleaned out. Okay, so it is the quarter bridge that is the that is giving you the half bridge result. It is a half bridge that gives you the quarter bridge result. So half bridge, you use 2 out of 4. That's why we call half bridge 2 gauges. You spend money twice as much for the strain gauge course. But what is the good thing? The first type of half bridge measurement is the half bridge measurement with the compensation. Compensation could be for the temperature compensation, or maybe the initial values compensation. Okay, so I'll elaborate in that. So you have 2 gauges, fine. Another gauge could be the resistor if you want. Okay, so you use the onboard resistor, on hardware resistor, which are R3 and R4. That is on your A2D. You put 1 resistor on your half bridge completion. We have the reason for that. So this one could be strain gauge or resistor. Okay, and another one must be the strain gauge, of course. So this is so called the active dummy method. Active dummy method, you will get the sensitivity which is the same as quarter bridge, but you are cleaning up some issue that makes that quarter bridge measurement not possible. Okay, so what is that? First, we look at this. The first case, the first situation, you need to clean out the temperature effect from this, right? Okay, you have the tensile strain and then you have delta T. Delta T costs you the temperature effect. Temperature effect is equal in this direction and also in this direction. But the point is that this gauge must be debonded. Or unbonded. Maybe, I think unbonded is okay. Perfectly unbonded from the substrate. If you bond the gauge on the substrate, you will have the active method. You get the different coefficient. Okay, this is practically debonded. So the debonding material I mentioned last time, that we can put the silicone for the heat transfer point of view. So you can put the small piece of maybe steel or aluminum, exactly the same material as your substrate. A little piece on the top, so it could be like this under the strain gauge. And this piece is connected to the substrate by that silicone. So I showed you here, and you have so the green layer is silicone. The red is the strain gauge. This material and this material, same material. but this is thin. You don't want this to be too thick. Otherwise, the heat delta T at the top and delta T at the bottom will be different due to the heat transfer point of view. Okay, so this epsilon T and epsilon T are the same. Okay, so it picks up only epsilon T. It doesn't pick up the Poisson effect. Because if you stretch this out this direction, you get epsilon in this direction. But you will get the shrinkage, which is equals to nu, okay, Poisson ratio times the epsilon. Right, that is going to happen on the transverse direction. Well, this is 30%. If it is steel, Poisson ratio for steel is 0.3. So if you place it, you glue it, you bond it perfectly, you get Poisson effect of 30% or so. If you want to just clean out the temperature only, then you will do the dummy. Okay, so here is the terminal. Now you can see that A, B, and C are moving. Well, basically only C, not the A and B. C used to be there, right? It used to be here, C, previously. That's why you need the short circuit, or you need the Y from this to this point, C. But now the C is changing to this side, so it is possible for you to put the whole strain gauge in there, alright? So C is changed to this point. So the terminal is not actually static. The program will control this terminal, and then that makes your dice gate inside, and then it switch around, so your C can be moving around. Okay, fine, that's a data locker thing, but the point is that we are emphasizing on where we want to see what's gonna happen inside the circuit. What will be the reading, which is according to the effects we have from the strain gauge placement like that. We are looking at this R1. We have just two, R1 and R2. R1 is an active gauge. R2 is a dummy gauge. The R1 picks up the delta R1. Delta R1 is from mechanical strain. Okay, you have the lead Y, one leg is 2L, you have two leg of lead Y, one leg is RL, so two legs is 2RL, okay. I can just remove this thing out, okay. That RL includes the delta RL as well. And then temperature, okay, of course the number 2, the R2, we put it there to pick up the temperature effect. Okay, it's there, delta RT is there. Of course the 2RL is there, because we also need to use the R2 to compensate the lead Y effect. So we will not start with the big initial drift. That's the reason. Okay. I group these two together. I group the RL and RT. I call it delta RM. Okay. So the only difference we have is just this one, delta R1, the mechanical strain in the gauge number 1. Plug in 1 and R2. R3, R4 are not affected at all. And that makes this, you cross this up, you cross this one up, and then you do the math. You clean out the R, the delta RM. When delta RM is gone, we feel good because the temperature effect is gone and the lead y effect is gone. Okay, this is the beauty. You have only delta R1. Well, as long as you have delta R1 without anything over here, without this, it is good. If you have this, you know that delta R1 is a small number, and you have something add up on the back of delta R1. This is the part that changes the story, makes your life not as beautiful as it should be. So, pull out the part here, this part, delta R1 over R, zero, right? Your strain is small. The delta RM over R, keep it there, because you have RL, okay? You have RL. At least the RL is the part that you can take care of. RL plus delta RL. Delta RL is from that I mentioned, the lead Y change of resistance. The lead Y is exposed fully to the sunlight, and then you have the resistance of the lead Y change. All those things there. But this one we don't know. It is small compared to the RL, right? And then we have the temperature strain. Well, it is still insignificant if you compare with the R, right? Delta RT over R, small, zero. Delta RL over R, small, zero. RL over R may not be small, so may not be zero, and may be incorporated in your calculation. So you have the 4 plus 4 RL over R. Okay, I will just adjust some of this thing, but okay, the RM thing, well, the RL is included in there, but I will do the adjustment and make it to RL so it is easy for you to look at. One remark, in the data logger manual, sometimes the RL are defined in a different way. Okay, the R times L, the L sometimes represent the whole Y, for example. So they call it little r and L over 2, little r and L over 2, like this. Okay, the little r is the resistance per length, multiplied by length, and this is one leg. Oops, sorry. L, okay, like this. Is it? They call L over 2 or... L over 2, okay, over 2. So the whole length is equal to L. I mean, if you put the strain gauge and you stretch the Y like this, this is equal to L. So one leg is RL over 2, RL over 2. But for us, one leg is equal to R subscript L. I use the R subscript L in my derivation. Okay. So that means if you read in the data logger manual, then this number will be different by 2 times. Different. Okay, but it's just a different definition of how I come up with the RL. My RL is 1Y on one leg, but there are L is, yeah, one leg is just half of the total RL. Okay, just that. Okay, so you say, hey, this is 4, but in that manual it said 2. It is the same thing. You just well, just understand how I count it and how they count it, and we'll get the same thing. So work further in order to get the coefficient. So strain is equal to the vapor wall reading and multiply by this coefficient. Still we, okay, I'll clear all this inconsistency. It's supposed to be RL, okay, and then I fix it. So GF about 2 again. Then you get nothing in terms of coefficient. It's not different from the quarter bridge, but you don't have temperature effect in there. And as I used to mention that you measure steel thrust in the air, in outdoor condition, and temperature effect is going to be serious. Actually, we should play this. We should try put one substrate and then sort of this make this piece. One piece is for tension, okay, to pick up the tensile strain. Another piece is to correct the tensile strain, okay. So it could be just like a strip of aluminum hanging. Like this, okay, you have the support, we hang it, you have strain gauge. So this is fully exposed to the sunlight. Okay, we need to make it. Okay, we need to do this. This is fully exposed to sunlight. Well, let's see. So we will have two counterpart systems. Actually, the strain gauge are exactly the same. We put the silicone on the back of these two gauges. First one, you can do the quarter bridge measurement. So this is one quarter bridge channel. This is another quarter bridge channel. Okay. You load it up. If you know the thickness of this aluminum strip, if you go up Wikipedia, you find the elastic modulus of aluminum. Then you know how much strain you expect if you know the force P. Okay. Then you don't apply force P just one time. It is not fun. If you just put 100% P, then you don't see anything. So P will be like the increment, 5-step, 10-step, whatever. We want to be able to plot the P versus strain. And it's supposed to be the tensile strain. So first, if you take the tensile strain from the first gauge, well, this is exposed to sunlight, so it heats up, it cools down, sometimes the fan, the wind blows, okay? So supposedly you should have the linear relationship between force and strain. You don't get that. You might get this because of the temperature. And then another quarter bridge channel hooked up with the floating gauge, okay, unbonded gauge. This will read only temperature. So temperature reading cannot be plot versus P anyway. But you will plot the red dot, which is the first one minus this one. So you get the reading here, and you get the reading from this one here. You know the temperature strain, you compensate the temperature strain out, and you will be able to plot and get the corrected strain, which is going to be giving you much better result. In the meantime, you have the half bridge. So two gauges will be combined into one half bridge system. Okay. One half bridge system, then what you get from one channel will be automatically just the mechanical strain well compensated. Alright, well compensated mechanical strain. So you will not waste two channels. You use just one channel, but you put two gauges in there. Well, if you want to know temperature on the material, if you want to plot the fluctuation of the temperature, you need to do the two-quarter bridge channels. Because the half bridge just automatically clean out the temperature, so you will not see the temperature information. You cannot plot the temp versus time. If you really want to know this, okay, if you really want to see, okay, how fluctuation is the temperature strain, you will have to use two channels. But if you don't care, just get rid of it, then you use one half bridge channel, you save the channel. So that depends on your preference. And then this one, you don't have to do anything because the reading will be automatically the corrected value. Putting everything outdoor and test is a very challenging situation for the testing. You know that you put the incremental load, you should get the incremental strain, the same increment as the load, but once the temperature is there, you get the nightmare. Okay, so this is the first application we talk about for the for the active dummy method. We can do things which is a little bit, it is again the active dummy method, but you change from the strain gauge to the resistor. So this is a resistor, you can find in the market. Well, mentioned last time, if you don't want this resistor to be heated up, you use the resistor for large current. In the Wheatstone bridge for the strain gauge measurement, the current is generally like less than 100 milliamp. It is like 20 or something milliamp. Okay, it is not that large, but okay, we can opt for really really large capacity resistor for really large current, so the temperature change will be minimized and you will not get frustrated by this issue. Okay, so put the resistor in there, replace the strain gauge by resistor. Why should we do this in her application? Okay, she suffered from the problem because most of the time the semiconductor strain gauge, okay, told you very good in terms of sensitivity. The bad thing, which is a consequence, we cannot manufacture the semiconductor gauge to be precisely 120 ohm. It is off in general, like from 117 to 123 or even more. Okay, plus minus 4 ohms. 1 ohm is practically 6,000, 7,000 microstrands. Okay, so 4 ohms, that makes you out of the measurement range. So if you go for the larger range, the range of 200,000 microstrain, that gives you the resolution of 10 microstrain for one increment. Well, if you push the structure, okay, fine, you will get the strain in steel up to 10,000 microstrain level, so you are fine. For those of you who run the experiment in the lab, for Hans, that does the very small strain measurement, she's not happy because the maximum could be 2 microstrain, but one increment, one step, you get from that is 10 microstrain. You don't even get anything, okay? Don't mention about waveform. 1 microstrain is bad enough already, right? If it is like this, but then 10 microstrain, so it is terrible. So the start here is that here is totally out. So that could be, well, if we want to call it the R part, that is 120, and you have another part of R which is about 4 ohm, it could be plus minus, right? R120 and R4 and then plus R lead Y. So these two have to be compensated. And to compensate, you are not trying to correct the temperature. You are trying to correct out this imperfection. Resistance of the strain gauges comes out of the factory. So basically, you put the resistor that is equal to 120 plus 4 plus that RL. You have this piece plugged in here, and it is taken care of by the delta RM, right? So this part here will be the 120 ohm part. Well, it is like breaking your strain gauge into two parts. So you have the 120 ohm parts, and then the part that is beyond or below the 120 ohm. Now it is beyond 120 ohm first. Okay, you have 124. Okay, let's say. So that 4 ohm things is incorporated in here, in here, in here. You work on this, you can see that that's all compensated out. Then you'll be happy. It doesn't affect this volt per volt reading. Now, so you just need to measure your full system lead wire, add up with the strain gauge, you get 120 something, and then you find the resistor that has the 120 something very close to your strain gauge, and then you hook it into the terminal, and you use ABC, right? So you hook it between B and C. The AB will be the active gauge. Okay, so B and C is the dummy, but it is not the gauge, it is the dummy resistor. Now, what if you have 116 ohm? What if you have 116 ohm? Two options. First of all, keep the R120 here. Here you have 116. You find the 4 ohm R to put in series. If you put in series with the 116, you get 120. And then the bridge will balance. So this is how it looks like. Your strain gauge, this is a lead wire and this is a lead wire, and then you have the resistors. Okay, so that makes between here and here 120 ohm. Okay, or another approach, you just leave it 116, you don't add 4 ohm there, and then you change this from 120 to 116 ohm here. Again, you have that delta RM being the negative number, but they will cancel out, so you end up with something you like again. So two possibility. Generally, which one did you do?
Same
as the active gauge, right? So, no matter big or small, right? You just put the same. Okay. Yeah. If she doesn't do that, hook into the quarter bridge many times. 40% could be up to 40%, right? 30 to 40% of the gauge we have, we show the red number. Red number means exceed the length, the range of measurements already. So at the moment you hook up, you get red numbers. Out of 100 gauges, you can get the information from just 60 gauges. We don't install the gauge and we don't expect that it's gonna work just only 60 or 70%. We expect them to work like 100%. Worst case scenario, if the gauge is dead, okay, if the gauge is dead, that means a short circuit going on inside the gauge. The wire that solder to this point is broken. If it is dead, okay, we cannot do anything with it. Alright? It's inside the concrete. It is broken already. You cannot replace the new one if you cannot replace the new one. Okay? If you can, like the surface gauge, you can replace the new one. But if you embed it inside the rebar, you cast concrete, you cannot do anything with it. Okay? Irreplaceable. If you can replace, replace. But if you get the red numbers, but the point is not about the broken gauge. It is about the initial reading is out of range. Then you better not just, sorry, this one is broken. Because the broken is not describing this situation. Broken describes the gauge is physically broken. This situation is just gives you the out of measurement range. And it is the situation that if you watch this video already, you know how to fix this situation. Okay, so you will not just throw away that 200 baht for strain gauge and maybe multi 100,000 or well something, okay, specimen. You lose one gauge, sometimes you lose quite a lot of information. If you don't lose this one, you might be able to interpret maybe like the curvature of the whole strain, the strain distribution of the whole cross section. Those things can be interpreted, but leaving it there, you're not getting that perfect interpretation. And okay, this cross section you lose a couple, another cross section you lose a couple, another cross section lose a couple. You don't get a perfect one. When you want to write the paper, when you want to present this, it is not convincing to people because you have just 3 out of 5. So fix it. So before the testing time, check using the ohmmeter, you can do it roughly. Use the ohmmeter, but when you use the ohmmeter to check the resistance between two locations, generally the ohmmeter comes with the sticks, two sticks. Each stick connect through the wire to the ohmmeter. So in order to connect the stick to the lead wire, you use your hand and then you hold it. So when you use your hand and you hold it, okay, this is what happened. This is the 120 ohm. And then you hold your hand there. This is 2 points, right? So you hold your hand, then this is your body resistance from your body. Okay. So the reading will be the ohm that comes out of these 2 points, including your from left arm all the way to the right arm. So what is it? 1 over R is equal to 1 over 120 plus 1 over something. And I'm not sure if the noise will come into my microphone. The better the microphone is, the more noise coming in. So sorry. Then we have 120 plus question mark divided by 120 times question mark equals to 1 over R. Or R is equal to 120 question mark divided by 120 plus question mark. So if the question mark is infinity, so you have the infinity cancel out, you get something approximately 120. If it is small, okay, so you'll be getting the error out of this measurement. This is the reading you get from your ohmmeter. So you can check, get the ohmmeter and check your arm resistance from one to the, well, there is no big current. You don't feel anything. You just touch it on two sides and then you will see the number. Well, that's why when you do it different time, you don't get the same R. Sometimes because of the dust on your fingers, and that change your resistance of your body. So all possibilities. But what I want to point out is that if the R of your body is not infinite, you'll be ending up with the error number. And then you will say to me that, sir, I checked the resistance before I hook it up. I checked the resistance, all the resistance, and then I prepare the resistors according to the resistance that I came up with from the measurements, but still I get the red number. And that could, well, partially be the case because you use the fingers to hold and to measure, and you by chance measure your body resistance together with that strain gauge resistance. So the best way, well, you can modify that clamp, that stick, that metal stick, and use the clamping. Okay, just avoid touching the wire. If you touch, you could get it wrong. I don't know how much, but sometimes I feel that, okay, we connect, we measure it this way, and number turns out to be incorrect. This is also applicable to the strain measurement, the absolute strain measurement, because the data logger one type, the A2D, that is used to measure the strain gauge is measure the actual resistance. The actual resistance, you don't need the Wheatstone bridge system. It reads the resistance, high resolution resistance. Just one channel, it costs like 10 times or 20 times of the normal data acquisition. It is 100,000 for one module. One module reads just one channel. And that one channel reading we have, it is not the dynamic, it is just the very slow rate, reading rate. But it reads the absolute strain. Okay, so that is possible. That is one way to measure strain, but it is extremely expensive. And using that tools is coming along with the it needs to measure the Y resistance, right? So it comes with the something like the grip that will not require the hand in order to hold the Ys on two sides to connect with the system. Yeah, I should go back and check if it is still, the battery is still in my module. I have one module like that. Generally, it is good for our long-term measurement. We put strain gauge, we leave it there in the concrete. We come back again next year, next month, or whatever. We don't really have to leave the data locker and hook it up to the strain gauge, to the wires, like that. The reason is the reading you have from the bridge measurement, it is subjected to your three resistors in the circuit. So in general, when we use the Wheatstone bridge measurement, first of all, you will get the initial value, non-zero. Okay, no matter how good you try to compensate your gauge, you still get the non-zero value. Non-zero value means you have the circuit flowing. Even at the beginning, before the test, you can even get the high accuracy, the high precision resistor, 120 ohm, plug it in instead of strain gauge, and see the initial reading. Initial reading is still not zero. Why isn't it zero? Of course, each resistor is not 100% 120 ohm. It has error. Error is extremely small, but still there and detected. So what is the meaning? If today you use your A2D, you get the strain gauge hooked up to one channel, maybe channel number one in the data locker. Tomorrow you switch the cable to the channel number two. You have a chance that the initial reading will not be identical. Well, basically you can do it today, both. Today hook up to channel number one, and today hook up to channel number two, and three, and four, and five. You get four different initial readings. And that four initial readings come from the error of each resistor you have in the Wheatstone bridge circuit. That's the issue. Okay, so that means for the Wheatstone bridge measurement, you need to hook up the data locker to the gauges or the sensors. Once you turn it off, you unhook, maybe you hook it back again, you might even at the same channel, you might even end up with a little different. But okay, same channel, you have the less chance to be having the different initial reading, but you might have some. It could be like some minor detailing when you screw the Y to the terminal, sometimes the rust or something. Okay, but the other approach, the expensive approach, is to measure the resistance, the actual resistance, because we know that delta R over R is going to be equal to strain. So it measure the resistance, absolute resistance. That could be done, right? But yes, if you use your hand to hold the wire, I used to have, of these cautions, I experienced that already. So one time that, actually this, the grip come with the unit. The point is that there are too many readings to do. So I grip the first set of gauge and then grip the second set. I have like 30 or 40 sets and then there are many load steps. So finish the whole thing and then I grip again. Okay, second round, third round. So the grip is broken. The soldering is broken out. As it broke out, then I still need to measure the strain. I need to just peel off the insulation and then just use my hand to hold and connect the circuit. Alright, and then that turns out to be, when you plot everything out, the strain turns out to be quite funny. But why is it weird like that? Okay, it is quite an important issue. Anyway, I think now you know how to make use of active dummy half bridge system. Very useful for the correction. Okay. Third, we have the perfectly glue. This is perfectly bonded to the surface. Still, we take the measurement of just one side. So it is the bending strain, but it is a bending strain on one surface, and the other one is just taking care of the Poisson effect. Now, the second gauge, second active gauge, takes care of temperature and Poisson effect. So let's take a look. When you strain it out, if you have axial strain or if you have the positive delta R1, you'll be having on the transverse direction minus epsilon delta R1. This is the Poisson. This is how Poisson ratio comes in. Okay. So stretch in one direction and then contract in the orthogonal direction. Delta Rm includes the lead wire, includes the temperature, includes all undesirable things. So we have exactly the same terminal wiring diagram as before, A, B, and C. Exactly the same terminal wiring. The point is that this gauge just read more than just the trash. So we come here. The part here is different from the one we saw before. So you have the minus, sorry, this is not epsilon. Okay, I missed this one. This is Poisson ratio. Okay, let me clear. Minus Poisson ratio. So what is there in that page? Sorry. Poisson ratio, not epsilon. Quite terrible sound. Okay. So, plug in. This is R1, this is R1, this is R2. Add them up. Okay, you have this on the top, and then over here, this term, you get 1 minus Poisson ratio delta R1. Alright. You just cross this to the other side. You multiply this to this side. So you have 2R, 2 delta, and 2, and then you have 2R, and then in the bracket, and then 2 delta Rm. The thing is that you can play with the mathematics by yourself later, but the term will be gone. The term delta Rm will be gone. Lead Y effect was compensated. The initial R was out. You have only just delta R1 and 1 plus Poisson ratio. Over here, you previously, as you have to multiply, you have 2, and then the minus here, you get minus 1, and then minus Poisson ratio turns out to be plus Poisson ratio. So 2 and 1, you get just 1, and then minus Poisson ratio to the minus, then you get the plus Poisson ratio. Okay, you can look at that, play with it. Keep that, okay. So, work on it. Delta R1 over R, zero. Strain. This, you keep it. You keep the RL. Delta RL, you don't keep. Temperature small compared to R, you don't keep. You get this. So this delta RM will turn out to be the R subscript L. Okay, work a little bit, switch things around, you get this coefficient. So, if you don't consider this, fine. If the RL is small, then this is zero. Gauge factor is still the same, you get 2. The 1 plus Poisson ratio appear over there. So, what happened to your measurement? We talk about this. We talk about this. We talk about this number coefficient. The smaller, the better, right? So, what is the effect from the 1 plus Poisson ratio? Well, 4 is the same, gauge factor is 2 the same. Practically, without the 1 plus Poisson ratio, you get 2. But if you put this 1 plus Poisson ratio, you have the 1.3 in here. The 0.3 come from steel. The Poisson ratio of steel is 0.3. So, 1.3, you plug it in. Then, you have 4 divided by 2.6 rather than 4 divided by 2. Okay, so that improve your sensitivity. Okay, so the 1 unit strain will be associating with the larger volt per volt reading. Okay, so this one is the active method. Another type, we have the Wheatstone bridge on both sides, active as well, but this is the bending configuration. Previously, even though we measure the bending strain, but it is not the, we measure just one point, one mechanical strain point. Here is the active, and then we have two mechanical strain points. So the first one, as it is a top surface, and if you apply moment like this to your beam, you have tensile strain at the top and compressive strain at the bottom. So if I represent the strain or the resistance change due to the strain by the delta RB, you have tensile, so it will be the plus delta RB at the top and minus delta RB at the bottom, compressive strain. You have delta RM again. Delta RM includes the lead Y, includes the temperature. Okay? Terminal is like before. Then what we have? You have still these things, group it up to delta RM. You have this and this. Okay, so R1 and R2. Plug in. you end up with this form, cross this up, cross this up. So R will be cancelled out, the delta Rm will be cancelled out. So you have 2 delta Rb divided by 2 to this 4R. 1 over 2. You take this one out, you change into the volt per volt. So 2 divided by the gauge factor and this one. Gauge factor is 2. Previously this number is 4. So 2 divided by 2, you get 1. Better. Number gets smaller. Smaller than 4. Right? Smaller than 2 in the previous one. Or smaller than 2 divided by 1.3. Now this is 1.0. Okay. So it is sensitive. But you cannot get this sensitivity if you measure just tensile strain. Axially loaded member. The case is that this is the flexure, under flexure, so you have the same strain at the top and the bottom. If the strain at the top and the bottom are not identical, for example, if you measure like a wide flange cross section, the top flange is bigger than the bottom flange, you'll be getting the total difference of the strain at the top and at the bottom. Okay, this picture. You can use this setup, but if it goes like this, strain at the top and strain at the bottom. Well, it's not a good idea if you do this with the RC cross section, because it is difficult to determine the neutral axis and you don't know the state of the neutral axis. Because if you want to get one number, then you need to assume one neutral axis configuration. But okay, for steel it is quite clear, quite well understood. So the bottom flange is small, the top flange is large. Or maybe the T cross section. So strain at the bottom is large. Well, you put strain gauge, one at the top, one at the bottom, using half bridge configuration. What you get? Well, you obtain like pretty much the difference what you have, because it is, if you have equal and equal, now you get like twice of the gain you have before. Okay, so twice of the gain you had before is the difference between one which is compression and one which is tension. That's why you get the gain which is double. But if you don't have the identical strain, then you need to assume, or you need to figure out the neutral axis, and from that you'll be able to say that, okay, this proportion and this proportion, how much strain on the top and how much strain at the bottom. You will come up with just one reading, just one number. So one number, you need to break it into two numbers, because these two numbers are not identical. Okay. But situation like this, go with the quarter bridge. If you don't have the identical, if I were you, I'll go with the quarter bridge. And then two quarter bridge reading, it is easier to assume this strain profile. What is this one? Half bridge. Active, opposite leg, okay. Again, the same thing. The system, the member is subjected to the bending you have bending strain, but I put this in to the opposite leg. So this is number four. You put number one and number four. Okay. Well, you can see this point here that it is blank because this is not available. I mean, the terminal is not prepared for this configuration. Okay, the terminal is prepared for A, B, and C. If you want to do this, then you need to turn on the full bridge. And you need to put your own resistor into R2 and R4. So it's actually like a quarter bridge. You use two active strain gauge and two constant resistor. The point is that the terminal A, B, C cannot handle this one. You cannot put the strain gauge on that point. Okay, plug in. Get all things plugged in. You have the final result, which is identical to the case before for the bending strain measurement. Okay. Same sensitivity, one microvolt per volt for one microstrain. Next, full bridge. So, full bridge measurement, we can do it for two scenarios. Oh, it is not on. Two scenarios. The first scenario, we use it for the axial strain measurement. So for axial strain measurement, the setup is like this, R1 and R3, opposite, okay. They are installed and they are oriented with the direction of the tensile strain, whereas R2 and R4 are orthogonal, picks up the temperature compensation and lead wise and so on and so forth. So yes, you have four gauges. Basically, the R2 and R4, well, if you want to replace them by the constant resistors, it is possible. We have to work a little bit with that if you want to see how the temperature is compensated. Alright, so R1 over R1 plus R2 and then R4 over R3 over R4. Well, you have the same denominator, the numerator part. We have difference in here and in there. So minus and minus, you get plus 1 plus Poisson ratio delta R. All the way down to here, you get this. This is what? Pretty much the same. Okay. This is 2 divided by 2 divided by 1 plus Poisson ratio. So, less than 1 right now. Previously, the best one you get is 1.0. This coefficient. Now, the coefficient reduced. You get better resolution. And this is okay for just the axial strain measurements. Next one, full bridge. But this configuration, two gauges at the top picks up tensile strain, two gauges at the bottom picks up the compressive strain. So we have strain in all four gauges. And this is a wiring diagram, so you will need A, B, C, D terminal, and then you short circuit between the A and the point there at the bottom. All right, so plug in the value. We have two sets. The first set, number 1 and number 3, you have the plus delta R, and number 2 and number 4, you have minus delta R. Plug in. Minus and minus, you end up with plus. You have 2. Okay, cancel out, and then finally you get this form. Gauge factor, if it is equal to 2, then you get 0.5. So this is the smallest that you can get, the highest resolution that you will obtain. So generally the transducer, okay, the transducer used in the measurement, which is a bridge base, use full bridge. So they put as many active gauges in the system as possible, and the full bridge that they use is the bending mechanism full bridge. Axial mechanism full bridge is not going to be sensitive. As sensitive, sometimes it has to be the axial mechanism, like some sort of load cell. So the load cell with like a large capacity, then you might not be able to do it in the axial configuration. You need the not be able to make it in the bending configuration. So it has to be the axial, and you can see that some load cell sensitivity is not quite high. The range, the full range of the load cell is not quite high, because it is set up, it is made in the axial measurement configuration, axial strain measurement. Okay, that's quite a lot. Now we look into this summary. Okay, so the sensitivity, this coefficient is the inverse of this sensitivity. Okay, so things like this, you can compute it here, you get to sensitivity is 0.5 microvolt per volt. This is also 2, this is also 2, this is what, 2 divided by 1.3. This is 1. This is 1 divided by 1.3, and this is 1 over 2. Okay, so the coefficient that is scaled to your volt per volt is the inverse of the sensitivity. Okay, if you want to look in the other way around, like if you look into the sensitivity point of view, sensitivity is what is the strain multiplied by the sensitivity equals to the volt per volt. So same magnitude of strain but better sensitivity, so that excite and gives you the high output. In that way, you think of it that way. Higher sensitivity with the same strain, you get large output. Okay, when you get large output, well, it is good in terms of resolution, but you might get to the full range easily, because volt per volt gets larger and larger and larger, then it hits the full range. easily. So the quarter bridge in comparison with full bridge bending, if quarter bridge can go to like 20,000 microstrain, for the full bridge you can go to just 5,000, four times. Why? Because your hardware can account for the limited volt per volt reading. It is not controlled by the microstrain, it is controlled by the volt per volt reading. So higher sensitivity, you fit the full range easily. So 5,000 microstrain in full bridge gives you the same V output as 20,000 microstrain from quarter bridge. And then you hit the full range. Now, if you change the gauge factor into 120, then we get the 40120, right? And then this is 1/30. 1/30 coefficient. Extremely sensitive. Or this, if you change it into the sensitivity, then you get what? 30 microvolt per volt for 1 microstrain. Something happened, 1 microstrain, you get 30 microvolt per volt. In general, the A to D can go like to, I think, about 0.5 microvolt per volt is okay for NI, the NI module. I remember that about 0.5 microvolt per volt is still good. Okay, so that means if 1 microstrain equals to 30 microvolt per volt, so 1 microstrain will be divided by data locker is okay to 0.5 microvolt per volt. Okay, and you need 60 of this 0.5 microvolt per volt to make 30 microvolt per volt, right? So you have 60 division for 1 microstrain. So this is 1 microstrain, and then you break it into 60 divisions. So each division, if it is about 50, that means 1/50, which is equal to 0.02. 0.02 microstrain. Semiconductor strain gauge. If you use your strain gauge, then you get 1 microstrain resolution. So a lot better possible for small strain measurement. But small strain measurement is generally for very specific application, like the ambient effect measurement, ambient strain measurement. You need extremely small. The wind blows to the building. Well, when you design a building for wind, you use the design wind. Actually, the normal wind speed is like almost 10 times lower. Yeah, about just a fraction. And then you design the foundation, the core wall, to be larger to account for not only just the wind, but also the dead load, gravity load. And the gravity load dead load, you have the load factor. The live load, you have the load factor. And in fact, for the live load without load factor, it's actually larger than the real live load in the building. The building like this, the room like this, should be designed at about 400 to 500 kilograms per square meters for the university, school, corridor area. You look around, you don't see people, of just a few, all right, in this room, including the furniture, including everything. It is still less than half of the design life load. So the member is very stiff compared to the ambient load, which is very small. The wall size, column size, huge. You end up with just one microstrand. Even for the bridge. For a bridge, oh, you use ash door, you use the line load, you put the truck load, you try it into the worst case scenario for each load combinations. You decide for the envelope that covers all combinations. So you design for the worst of the worst. Okay. The thing is that when you measure the ambient condition, we used to do that, and it gives a lot of pain. At that time, we used just the normal gauge, concrete gauge. We stick it there. Even in the night time, the truck runs. Boom, 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 boom. You can feel the vibration. You thought that it is heavy already. 5 microstrain. 5 microstrain. When you test your specimen, Suyi and Nontopa, you test your specimen, you will find something like 1,000. Yeah, easily. You reach to the yield plateau, you get like 2,000 for the SD40 steel grade. Now we are talking about 5. 5, you just move hydraulic jack just one time and then you get more than 5. But here, it is as small as that. So, again, the application is different. You don't want to put semiconductor in your test, and you don't want to use the metal foil gauge in the ambient vibration test. Okay, right. Done for this video. I need to record the previous video because it has no sound. So